This is Headliners and Legends with Matt Lauer.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to Headliners and Legends. There have been some fabled comeback kids in the history of show business, but few as fascinating as Tina Turner. She's defied age, trends, and the private hell of an abusive marriage to emerge as a unique artist and personality. In fact, she is such a survivor that by now there are probably several generations who may never have heard the real Tina Turner story, an odyssey that began in Nutbush, Tennessee, and turned into a legend that would rock the world.
Tina Turner, in her seventh decade, is at her peak. Her career is stronger than ever. She's in love with her boyfriend of more than 10 years. Home is a Riviera villa furnished with pieces once belonging to a French king. But happiness and success wouldn't come easily or early. Tina Turner is born Anna Mae Bullock on November 26, 1939, near the tiny agricultural town of Nutbush, Tennessee. Cotton is the main crop here. Her family lives and works on a sharecropping farm where her father is the overseer. Home is a battlefield for Anna Mae and older sister Aline. The shouting matches between her parents, Richard and Zelma, are well known throughout town. Zelma is unhappy in the marriage, and Anna Mae is an unwanted child.
I wasn't a love of my mother. During the time of her pregnancy with me, she was in the process of leaving my father, and found out that she was pregnant.
Beginning when she is three, Anna Mae's parents abandon her and Aline for years at a time. She's separated from her sister and stays with her strict Baptist grandmother. Forced to attend Sunday church and wear crisply starched dresses, Anna Mae is unhappy at Mama Roxana's. She finds solace roaming the nearby pastures, escaping into her fantasies.
She was a town boy now. Loved her wrestling, dude. Yeah, she would do that. Back then, see, we'd go to the store, and white people would give us a little money to fight. I had a friend I'd raised her with. He would give us a quarter piece, and we'd fight something like 30, 40 minutes. He'd get the best of me. Tina would get in. When I get
there, Anna Mae finds another refuge, singing in church. But it is the music more than the message that lifts her spirits and her voice.
When I was singing in church, I was really very young, and I didn't really listen to the preacher, and I didn't really read the words. So I'm saying that I wasn't singing about how wonderful God was, that I was a little girl that liked the music, and I was inspired by the music.
She always wanted to sing. She always wanted to sing.
Anna Mae is passed off to her other grandmother, but is essentially an orphan by the age of 12. She needs money and hears of a local family looking for a housekeeper.
She was at that time working in the cotton field and would do anything in the world to get out of the cotton field. And so I agreed to pay her what she would be paid in the cotton field. And we just hit it off immediately.
Connie Henderson becomes the strongest influence in young Anna Mae's life. An employer and surrogate mother, Anna Mae absorbs Connie's nurturing like a sponge.
I have never seen anybody with as much get up and go or motivation or whatever you call it as she had. She was just a very industrious child.
During the next few years, Anna Mae spends most of her time with Connie and her husband, Guy Tucker, working for them and caring for their son, David.
When I got the job for Miss Connie, she taught me all of these things. Everything I learned about my housekeeping and how I took care of her children, I used that knowledge when I raised my children, and it made me a superb housekeeper.
But in Tennessee during the early 1950s, Jim Crow laws are taken seriously, and the affectionate relationship between employee and employer is frowned upon.
People would make remarks. For instance, the neighbors. She loved David, so when she would hug him and so forth, and they didn't like the fact that this little black girl was hugging on my child.
In the summer of 1956, 16-year-old Anna Mae's grandmother dies, leaving her homeless. Unexpectedly, Anna Mae's mother reappears for the funeral. She has no intention of taking her daughter with her when she returns home to St. Louis. In desperation, Anna Mae turns to her employer, Connie.
Anna Mae asked me if I would, we had a storage shed, if I would put a window in it so that she could live there. And I told her that I didn't think it would be possible. And she cried.
Zelma finally agrees to take in her unwanted child. For Anna Mae, the move to St. Louis will have a greater impact on her life than she could ever imagine. Built on the banks of the Mississippi River, St. Louis is a fairly sedate city. But just across the river is East St. Louis, and it couldn't be more different.
East St. Louis was 24 hours a day, lots of gambling, lots of women, lots of booze, lots of nightclubs. It's a place where if you hit a band or something, this is the place to be, because there are all these clubs. There are all kinds of clubs.
The star attraction at one of the hottest clubs is the R&B band The Kings of Rhythm, and their leader is Ike Turner. When the 16-year-old Anna Mae walks in the club and hears the music Ike and the Kings play, she is mesmerized. It is an evening that will forever change the course of her life. Coming up, how Anna Mae erupts into Tina Turner and shows a Rolling Stone how to strut. In 1956, Anna Mae Bullock hears Ike Turner cast his musical spell for the first time and is overwhelmed by the rhythm and blues virtuoso.
He was a key player in black R&B. He played on early B.B. King records and Howlin' Wolf records. And I mean, he was an extraordinary guy and an extraordinary guitar player, too.
Ike is a local star with a shiny Cadillac, lots of women, and a reputation for pistol-whipping those foolish enough to fight him. Ike's music stirs something deep within Anna Mae. She shows up at his gigs week after week with one goal, to sing with the band. One night, she grabs her chance, grabbing the microphone.
Yeah, I know you love me, baby, but you never tell me so.
I ran around following those people, that band and all those people around for a long time, wanting to get on his stage. And when I got there, I was thrilled. I was singing. I was really expressing myself and finding out what it was really like.
Raw and powerful, her voice is unlike any Ike has ever heard. When the crowd goes wild, he knows she's something special. From then on, Anna Mae, still in high school, is singing with Ike's band every weekend, until Zelma finds out. Zelma Bullock objects to her daughter singing with Ike Turner. Anna Mae obeys her mother, but bristles at her order.
I don't like when she plays the mother role on me, because it's like, mother, don't start that. It's too late for that now, you know? Like, hold on just a second.
Ike is not going to let Anna Mae slip through his fingers. He charms Zelma into letting her daughter sing with him.
Tina always dreamed of a bigger life somehow. That's how she finally got into music, because it promised, you know, diamonds and furs and Cadillacs and stuff like that. And she was just a small town girl from the sticks, pretty much, with this phenomenal voice.
Anna Mae becomes Ike's grateful protege. He is her mentor, grooming and training her. At first, their relationship is platonic.
Ike had been very good to me when I came from Tennessee. We were friends. And I said to him, well, if we ever get a hit record, Ike, I won't leave you.
I won't leave you. Abandoned so often herself, it is a vow she intends to keep. The high school senior has a romance with the King's sax player, Raymond Hill, and she becomes pregnant. He soon leaves the band and Anna Mae. Still, she graduates in 1958, and that summer gives birth to her son, Raymond Craig. Soon, Ike wants more than just friendship with Anna Mae. Giving in to his demands, she again becomes pregnant the following spring. But babies don't interest Ike, already father to a number of children by different women. He's written a new song, and Anna Mae's searing lead vocal will finally get him what he wants, a hit record, and get her more than she bargains for.
Oh, there's something on my mind.
Won't somebody please, please tell me what's wrong?
That a cappella part when she's just like screaming out these lines. You hear that and you say, oh my goodness, what is this? Who is this woman?
Rising to number 27 on the pop charts, A Fool in Love is a big hit for Ike and Tina Turner. Anna May is stunned to discover Ike has changed her name, remaking her into his image of an exotic goddess. In an instant, she becomes Tina Turner. Ike wants to tour in support of the record, but a pregnant Tina doesn't want to go on the road. He changes her mind with a few blows to the head.
That was the first time he had actually violently beat me. We're not talking about a lick or whatever. This was actually the first time he ever hit me.
Hurt, scared, and pregnant, Tina agrees to tour. With the addition of three backup singers called the Ikettes, the Ike and Tina Turner Review is born. During the tour, Tina bleaches her hair, a momentary whim having a permanent effect.
We put a heat cap on, and when the heat cap came off, so did my hair. So I had to wear a wig. I began to like the wig. Oh, ho, ho, ho. I remember the first step of hitting the stage with his hair down my back, the crowd went crazy, and I went, this is it. This is obviously what it was supposed to have been.
Tina and Ike head west. Ike wants to settle in Los Angeles. There, Tina gives birth to her second son, Ronald Ronell, in October 1960. Soon, she is getting beaten up regularly by Ike. He hasn't had a follow-up hit to A Fool in Love. Tina is becoming his scapegoat. Still, in 1962, Ike wants to get married. Tina, dependent financially and emotionally, unable to resist, agrees.
I was afraid to say no because it would have been a physical fight, and so I said yeah.
Ike books the Review as often as possible. He is a taskmaster, pushing her to her limits. Still, Tina sizzles on stage. Performing in Los Angeles, she is seen by legendary record producer Phil Spector. Blown away by her voice, he pays Ike $25,000 to let him record her alone. Although credited to Ike and Tina, River Deep Mountain High is Tina's solo. When released in the spring of 1966, it is the vocal performance of her career. It is also an enormous flop.
It bombed in this country. I think it was like number six or something abroad, but it just nobody wanted to hear it here.